Hello and welcome to a rewatch of Game 4 of the 1984 NBA Finals. We have classic Boston Celtics versus Los Angeles Lakers, and we have an NBA legend in Mr. Cedric Maxwell. Mr. Maxwell, it is an honor to have you here with us. And also, Jaron, I have to immediately say, it is very interesting that you have chosen to immediately go Los Angeles Lakers gear against him.
Listen, we talked about it. I can't lie to you and make it look fly to you. Born and raised a Laker fan. I got my people out there. I don't want them telling me I was scared of Mr. Maxwell. I turned in my Laker Nation card just because I was on stream with the Celtics legend. I know Max is a little disappointed in me, but I know deep down he appreciates the honesty. I'm super excited. Not every day you can wake up and watch one of the best finals game, which we're about to watch, Game 4, 1984. This is one of the best with an NBA legend. So I'm extremely excited to get this going. Max, let us know what it was like going into this game, because this is kind of the reignition of the Celtics-Lakers rivalry. The last time they met was in 69. So you had known about the rivalry, but this was the first time since 69 that they played each other in the finals. So did it feel different going into this series than, say, the 81 finals, which you won finals MVP in?
Well, it did. In the fact that I think about Houston, and that year, 1981, we thought that the Lakers were going to be the team that came out of the West. And they got beat by Houston. I mean, Houston beat them. And then it was all of a sudden, it was like, okay, now what are we going to do now? What are we going to do? And then when we finally met, it was all the animosity, all the rage. It was classic NBA basketball, and it was good on this side versus evil on the other side over there. So I loved it. The fact that Larry Bird and Magic Johnson were meeting for the first time in the finals. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, my guy, Robert Parrish, loved Kareem. He loved, idolized Kareem. I hated James Worthy. You know, we had a lot of hatred and animosity. My guy, ML Carr, there was a lot of angst about him. It was just a great time to be in the NBA. And for me, this game, this series jump-started the NBA. The game before this, number three in LA, the Lakers beat us like a drum. And what I remember about it so well was after the game, they beat us by 32 points, game three. So it was 2-1. And after the game, I'm driving and near Santa Monica, and I'm listening to the radio, and they said, how's the series going? And the guy said, is it over already? And this lady said, no, it's not over yet, but the fat lady sure is singing right now. So that really just got us even gassed up. So in game four, this game was probably one of the most physical games I've ever played in. I mean, I've never been in the Army, but damn, it felt like it.
Okay, so we are looking at the start of game four right now. And you mentioned game three with Magic Johnson. Magic had 21 assists in game three. So we're talking about physical. Also, what adjustments were you looking at going into this game to cut off Magic with his passing? Because as you said, you know, the Lakers had over 130 points.
We had a guy named Dennis Johnson, who was a Hall of Famer, offensively and defensively, which stuck to Magic like glue. And we absolutely loved it. And we said before, in practice, we said that day that the physicality was going to be ramped up. They wanted to play a pretty game, and damn it, we were going to make it an ugly game.
Wow, that's crazy. So going into this game, like you said, game three, the Lakers beat you pretty heavily. And Jerry West, after that game, he had came out and said, if the series ended right now, James Worthy would be finals MVP. And you responded to that. You said, you know, it took me six games to win finals MVP, which you won in 81 against Houston. And so you kind of had this back and forth with Worthy. You were obviously matched up with him. Can you tell us a little bit about what that mini rivalry within the rivalry was like and what made James such a tough guard?
Oh, are you talking about Little Game James? Is that what you're talking about? I'm sorry. He became Big Game James later on. But in this series,
right.
I didn't think he was Big Game James. He was a guy who could play at a high level. He was intense. He was probably one of the most athletic bigs we've had in the NBA in a long time, especially playing at the three position at about 6'9".
Well, we talked going into this about the NBA with competitiveness and how we had thought, you know, the league had started to get a bit soft when it comes to trash talk, when it comes to who's really about it. So I'm curious. All right, you just said Little Game James Worthy. Was James Worthy someone who was really about it at this moment? Was he still competing at that kind of level?
He had just started at that level. You know, yeah. You'd think he was a great player. He was going to be a great player. He was truly, to me, he was an all-star. But when we played him in this series, I didn't think about it in that way. You know, I thought about, you know, what I could do and how I had to handle him, and I had to get into his head. I mean, he was a shooter. He was a scorer. He could rebound. And if he was running along with Magic, that was one of the things that you wanted to stop. You wanted to stop that guy, that deep voice announcer, the public address. I love it. And he was like, Worthy of Magic. We wanted to make sure we stopped that particular noise, because every time he said that, the crowd got amped up. And the thing you hated about L.A., was the fact it was so glitzy. You know, you had Dancing Barry doing his dance in the sidelines. You had the Laker girls, you had Jack Nick. It was so cool that it made you almost sick as a basketball player.
Interesting.
Yeah, long way from Kingston, North Carolina, right?
Yeah,
long way from Kingston, but you know, you said about Kingston. Kingston's had this going with this, which was crazy. The fact that Kingston, North Carolina, population-wise, had developed more basketball players than any other little city in the country. You know, myself, Brandon Ingram is from there. You know, we've had a lot of great basketball players that came in from Kingston. Jerry Stackhouse, guys who played and played well.
Absolutely, yeah.
That is incredible. With that kind of relationship with Stackhouse, have you been kind of like a mentor to them, as you know, as you guys have been from like a smaller kind of community like that, as they themselves progress towards the pro ranks?
No, we really haven't. We really didn't talk to. I don't think we've all been together as basketball players ever. But we have a commonality in the fact that we both understood the game. We all played at high levels. You know, you look at Jerry Stackhouse, what he did, the way he played. You know, it's one of those things where you just love it. I mean, don't you love the steal I just made then? Dish off. Oh, see, I'm talking about.
You know what I loved about that? You ended up with the steal, but Gerald Henderson, whose son played in the NBA, I think a lot of our younger viewers remember him. He came from Duke. That's his dad right there. He matched up with Magic. Now, Magic was 6'9". You know, he was a point guard. Obviously, there's a huge size disadvantage in pretty much any team he plays. And you would think, hey, let's put a bigger guy to try to match his size. But then Magic would just beat you with his quickness and his dribbling. To put Gerald Henderson on him, who was a smaller guy compared to Magic, he's able to kind of get under him a little bit and poke at the ball, which he did right there, and then it got loose and you ended up with the steal. So was that something that you guys, Casey Jones, wanted to put? He didn't want to match him size for size with Magic. He didn't mind having a smaller guy like DJ or Gerald Henderson on Magic because of that purpose?
Well, It essentially, early on, we had Gerald on him, and then it turned into Dennis Johnson, a bigger, stronger guy, getting him on the post and operating from there. You know, there's Kareem again, like he's never fouled in a damn year. I love Kareem, but man, come on, man. It's just like, you do foul. And we bring
out him and Tim Duncan. Right,
so, I, you know, these guys, I still have so much You know, here's the thing. I respect them, but I have so much animosity for them right now. I've said this before, and I'll say it again. When I was playing at that level, to me, it was, if I saw a Laker and I was on, and if they were in a car and they were on fire and I had some water, I drink the water. I wouldn't pour it on them. I wouldn't waste it on them.
Love it. I love the competitive fire still here all these years ago.
Yeah, that is. Well, at least you're staying hydrated, so you didn't waste the water yet, technically. I'm curious, with the glitz and glam of LA, you know, you guys didn't obviously have that persona at all, it sounds like. What were the pregame warmups like? What were, you know, obviously it's much more showmanship there. You know, as a basketball player, was it at all distracting, or was it more just motivating, like these guys? It feels like you were, you know, just again on a completely different wavelength.
Motivating, because this guy on screen right now hated him, you know, and I tell people that today. He was in the locker room. I saw him about 2 years ago. It was after Kobe passed away. He came in. We were having a little meeting, myself, the owners of the Celtics team, and Jeannie Buss were there. And Magic walks in the room, and he comes in, knocks on the door, and then he says, "Oh, I didn't know you guys were in here. I just came down from my suite." I was like, and then he walks over to me and he wants to shake my hand. I'm like, "Dude, really? You?" I said, "I'm not shaking your hand, man. I'm not doing that."
Oh my. So you still felt the showman was in him there with the
suite. He is. And here's the thing about it. As much as I dislike him, I respect him as a businessman, and I respect him more as a person who's done so much for the Black community and the way he has just gotten things going. I love that about Jane. I love that about Magic. You know, he's reached out. He's become this great entrepreneur. He's got all these things going. I love that about him. But again, just the total disdain as a basketball player, I still have that. I still have that competitive fire.
I mean, understandable to me, especially. So I'm interested. It sounds like you very much have Larry Bird's back, right? But when I had been reading, you know, like early 1980s articles of like Sports Illustrated back then, it had appeared that, you know, you being there before Larry, averaging 19 a game, you know, it appeared that the media was trying to make some kind of back and forth between you and Larry, as you being an established star on the team before Larry got there, and then Larry, you know, yes, coming in with everything he came in. So, and then did that get settled while you guys were playing?
That
was it settled?
We got that settled in the first day of camp when I'm playing against Larry Bird, and I'm like, he came in and I'm thinking like, okay, I'm averaging 19 and 10. And I'm thinking like, okay, this guy is coming in and he wants to be the star of this team. And I said, I'm already doing that. And said, so we played the first day, and you know, I'm scoring on Larry, and I'm thinking in my mind, I said, well, he can't really score on me. And I guard him. He knocks down the first one, second one, third one. And I was, as a Black player, I had a lot of animosity against this guy. I was very prejudiced when it came to white guys playing out on the court. And I remember after practice getting to the first Black person I could see. And I said, you know what? That damn white guy down there can play. And that was my introduction. And at that time, there was no more animosity. I knew he was going to be the leader of this team, and I just had to follow suit.
That's commendable, I'd say, to just, you know.
No, that's pretty smart. That's all that would be. Like, you cannot.
Well, I'd say just because we've seen, well, maybe smart, you know. Well, I agree with you. I agree with you for sure. If the goal is to win a title, but, you know, I would say if we, you know, current players aren't always willing to be, you know, sacrificed in that way is what I mean.
Well, you know, you say that, and I remember that happening with Ricky Davis. Ricky Davis playing against, you know, playing with LeBron James. and LeBron James comes in, and Ricky Davis wants to be greater than LeBron. Dude, this is the future of basketball coming in. You're not going to be better than him. You're going to have to do whatever it takes right now. And you know, you fill in well. So what you saw in the fact that you learn to deal with that particular player and you deal with his skill set and what he's able to bring to the table.
Yeah, I think your ability to, you know, sacrifice for the team and, you know, want to win was one of the reasons why Boston Celtic fans adored you so much, because, you know, in 1993, Celtics hosted Larry Bird Night. And they had this ceremony on the court, and they brought everyone back, old former teammates, and you were there. You were actually the one presenting Larry Bird with, I think it was like a plaque or something. And Bob Costas out on the floor just said, you know, Max, how's it feel to be back in the Garden? And when he said that, the entire Garden, it wasn't just a standing ovation. It was one of the loudest standing ovations that I've ever heard. So for some, I think that coupled with your intensity, your feistiness, those Celtic fans adored you. But from your point of view, what was it that made you so connected with those fans? Because that standing ovation, I mean, everyone watching should look that up on YouTube. Larry Bird Night, 1993. It was loud in there.
That was, to me, that was one of the coolest moments for me as a basketball player to come back and be there for Larry's Night and to get that ovation. Bob Costas said it best. He said, look, you know what, Max, how's it feel to be back? And everybody knew that there was a lot of angst when I left, but I've always loved the Celtics. I've always loved that team. I had great teammates, and for me to be back for that particular night to celebrate one of the greatest players, not only in Celtic history, but in basketball history, to come back and play the game, That was the respect that I was giving him. And then the respect I got back was from the crowd acknowledging that I was there to present him.
Yeah, it was awesome. I highly recommend everyone go check that out, because those fans, they knew a real, you know, it wasn't just the stars that they loved. You were a star, you know, you were a finals MVP. I mean, everybody on this team, you know, those Celtic fans, they really rooted for their guys, especially you. And I think, again, it was because you weren't scared of anybody. Like we talked about earlier, you still hold that competitive, you know, edge on all of these guys to this day. And I think that's something that Boston fans, they just, that city really connects with those types of players. So that's what made you just, you know, one of the Celtics legends, which to say you're a Celtics legend is, it's got to hold more weight than, you know, another franchise, because the Celtics have had so many great players. So what was it like to have your jersey retired and you look up there and there's, you know, Bill Russell, John Havlicek, and all these other guys? I mean, what did that feel like, that moment for you to have your jersey retired?
Well, and you say that, and I have much respect for Springfield, the Basketball Hall of Fame. But when they retired my jersey, I remember saying that. I said, it was cool. I respect Springfield, but the Basketball Hall of Fame was where my number was going at. You're talking about the franchise that won more championships than anybody. Bill Russell had won 8 championships in a row. To be there and to be among one of those greats and to have your jersey retired was just awesome. And even today, I look up there at that scoreboard, man, and I'm just, I absolutely love what was there. And you know, you see playing the game in a high level and understanding, you know, what the Celtics were about.
Yeah, and, you know, I know Mike and I have talked about this in the past, so I want to, I don't want to put your feet to the fire, Mike, but Cedric Maxwell is a finals MVP, 1981. To me, that is an automatic ticket to the NBA Hall of Fame. I feel like that should punch your ticket every single time. And we talked about this in previous seasons with Andre Iguodala winning, and we debated whether or not he should be in the Hall of Fame. So, you know, I've like I said, I respect Springfield as well, but to have your number retired in, you know, the Garden, I mean, that's an incredible honor as well.
I mean, it is an incredible feat when you think about having your jersey retired, and you say that, but the Springfield, the Hall of Fame to me is for the elite. And there's some guys who aren't going to get in. you know, I've had some great moments as a basketball player. And, you know, to be a finals MVP, to have a game against the Lakers in this series, the seventh game where I had 24-8-8 championship game, seventh game, those are great moments. But the elite of the elite, those are the guys that I look at and say should be there. I'm one of those guys that would be on the fringe level. And to me, it's more of an honor because now you look at guys going, yeah, you should be. It's almost more of a badge of honor not to be there as a guy who's close than the guy who actually got there.
Well, you got there, you know, you also got the championships, which is, you know, the most important stat. You have the finals MVP. Absolutely. You know, I'm with you. Yeah, I mean, you know, that's kind of like an all-time question. Would you rather be a championship-winning player who's always in competition or be, you know, an NBA Hall of Famer? And you're, you know, right in the mixture for with both. So, with that said,
Here's the thing you get. You get maximum respect for guys that you played with and played against. And that's to me, that to me is the most important thing. I remember we had a guy, Jarrett Sullinger, was on the team a couple of years ago with the Celtics, and he was talking a lot of noise to me. He said, you know, man, you want that good. You weren't that good. You want that good. And then he goes off and he comes back and he said, oh, there's my guy, Cornbread, Jamal Wilkes. And Jarrett Sullinger came back and he said, during the summer, he said, I got big respect for you now. And I was like, why is that? He said, I went to the camp that Moses Malone was in and John Lucas. And I asked him, Moses, how were you? And he said, at Cornbread, he was an MF. And I just, and for me, that was just like, it was like icing on the cake, man. This dude, that one of the greatest of the game, talked to me in glowing terms. And that to me, that was so cool. It was so cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that respect for sure. Also, I cannot believe that out of everyone you just could have possibly named for the trash talk, Jarrett Sullinger was the one name. So, you know, no disrespect on that man, but wow. You know, I'm curious, going into these finals, you were a part of the Boston Celtics, which were, you know, the team that had won the most championships, and it had been a bit of time, and now we had Larry Bird coming in, where you guys went from, I think, somewhere around, you know, high 20 wins to, you know, suddenly 60, and suddenly you were right there in championship contention, and you actually closed a championship. I think it's very impressive within two seasons. It didn't take you guys a very long time to learn how to win in the playoffs. But I'm curious, what was that transition like to suddenly go from a team that wasn't in the playoffs to being the Boston Celtics historic franchise, you know, with that tag attached to the playoffs with Larry as well?
Absolutely amazing. When you think about where I was my first 2 years in the league, I had a connection. I played with John Havlicek. Got Red R back here on screen now, but played with John Havlicek. I played with JoJo White, Dave Cowens. And that was my rookie year, played with these legends. And all of a sudden, overnight, they became old. And my team went from a team that was competing to a team that was just challenging. And we played hard, and then we got lucky. Got lucky enough to, you know, get Kevin McHale and Robert Parrish in one fell swoop for Joe Barry Carroll. And you're talking about two Hall of Famers? Those guys really made, they were difference makers. You know, McHale is, people talk about Jokic right now and how great Jokic is. Jokic is Kevin McHale with an outside game. And Kevin McHale, once you got the ball to him in the post, very few people in the league were able to stop him with all these different moves. And a lot of those moves, he learned those things from me playing in practice every day.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that. You know, he came off the bench. He was the sixth man of the year this season, obviously. And when did the coach or the team, did they ever discuss, like, nope, McHale's coming off the bench? And was your spot in the starting lineup secure pretty much? You knew you were going to start no matter what. I know you guys played slightly different positions, but there could have been some sliding movement there where you know, Mikhail starts, and who knows, maybe some of the fans thought, you know, why is Mikhail coming off the bench to the untrained eye? But was there, did you have to look over your back in any way, or was it like, no, Max, you're our starter, don't worry about it, just go out there and do your job?
Yeah, that wasn't, I never thought of it that way, because I, you know, said my first, that year I was averaging like 19 points a game and 10 rebounds when Larry got there. And the next year I averaged 16 and 7, or 16 and 8, on a reduced role. So my role just had to change. And once we got Mikhail and we got Parrish, you saw my average go down and down and down, but we won more games. And I knew in my mind that there were going to be opportunities for me to shine, you know, being out on the floor with those great players that I played against and played with.
So you spoke, we saw Red Auerbach. I'm curious, because he did, you know, mastermind this whole, you know, within the span of a few years, managed to get Parrish, Mikhail, and Bird, and completely, you know, have another era for the Boston Celtics. What was he like? You know, was he involved with the team? What did he?
Red was, did he have that aura? Red was so involved with the team in so many aspects. We had an exhibition game one time against Philadelphia, and there was a fight in it. And I think this wasn't the Larry Bird fight and Dr. J, but there was a fight during the exhibition. And Red Auerbach comes out of the stands, walks onto the floor, and starts yelling at Billy Cunningham. Billy Cunningham is yelling at him, and they kind of go back and forth. Red tears his jacket. That's how involved he was. Can you imagine any other manager in any other situation that you look at and saying, this guy was going to come out? Can you imagine Pat Riley coming out of the stands right now, walking on the floor of a Heat game? That's what Red Auerbach essentially did, and that's how big he was as what an icon he was, you know, to understand the game, to draft Larry Bird as a junior eligible, to get Robert Parrish and Kevin McHale in a deal for Joe Barry Carroll. You know, just he was remarkable as a person and as a basketball talent. I remember the first time I ever met him was didn't meet him. I was at the National Invitational Tournament where I was playing really well. And somebody said, man, Red Auerbach's in the first row. And I looked over and I thought he was watching me. The man was sound asleep. I was like, what is going on here? So I think that you think about who Red was, and he'd always try to trick people because, you know, he understood, like, you know, what he was doing, and he would just kind of give you that shifty look. And if he liked you, he would go to sleep. If he didn't like you, he would stay and watch.
Oh my. So was he at the time, like, what was he considered, this all-time, you know, basketball great mind, because he had been a part of course, you know, all those Celtics? He was the head coach before this, the head coach in like everything from what I've read.
Red Auerbach just understood the game. Yeah. And the thing he understood about, you know, about playing it at a high level, and what he wanted to do more than anybody was just get the ball to other people and attack the rim. He wanted to run fast breaks all the time, run teams out of the gym, and he did a great job of getting the personnel. He had Tommy Heinsohn, he had JoJo White, he had Dave Collins, one of the smallest centers maybe ever in the NBA, to guard Kareem and Bob Lanier and those kind of guys. And Dave Collins became, you know, an unbelievable all-star. So you think of his talent level and how he went out and got people. That, to me, that was a cool thing about, you know, what Red Auerbach was.
Yeah, he was an incredible
GM. Don't you just hate all these Lakers people you're looking at on the sideline right now? Just a total disdain. I mean, here's the thing that I hated about the Lakers. They didn't the fans who came there, they would come late so they could be seen, and then they would leave early so they could be seen leaving. This series made Laker fans really basketball fans, because they came to see the game instead of, here's the thing I love about Laker fans, instead of being seen.
That's right. Well, yeah. The Forum Club was there too, so it wasn't just, you know, we're going to watch basketball, we're going there, you know, for the club as well. I wanted to ask you, as we were looking at those shots of the Laker fans, you know, today, all the NBA guys during the offseason, they go to LA. You know, they're always going to LA and everyone meets there. They have the workouts, they have the trainers and all that. Where did you go during the offseason? Did you go back home? Did you stay in Boston? What did Cedric Maxwell do during the offseason? Because I know he wasn't going to LA, or am I wrong?
Oh, no. When you couldn't have paid me money to go to LA during that time. You know, only time you could have paid me to go to LA was when we beat them in 84, the same year the Olympics were in LA, and a couple of teammates went out there. And we saw and said, man, this is some crazy stuff, man, when you think about the Lakers and what they do. So that's the only time I can think of ever wanting to be in L.A. for anything.
Well, I do want to say to everyone watching to make sure to download the NBA app as you are watching, if you are watching on a different social, or to follow the NBA on all of their socials. The NBA app now has a tremendous amount of historic games, which – you know, I don't take for granted, to be honest, because as I was growing up, you know, on early YouTube, we did not have access to this many games. I'm curious. Okay, so there's a lot of animosity that has been created, right? And there's a lot of, like, the big moments that we get shown. Like, for instance, you know, the choke sign. That's a big moment. Mm-hmm. But what were the little things that the Lakers were doing that were, you know, creating more of that animosity? Was there any other players that might be, you know, Bob McAdoo, for instance, a surprise kind of guy that was, you know, out there particularly being annoying? Yeah.
Bob McAdoo was one of my best friends. And that's the only time I would say that I actually had some compassion towards a guy from the Lakers. He didn't do anything, and Kareem was like the dude, man. I love myself Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Man, you just don't – his way of playing the game to me, and I told him this later on. I said, when I was in college, I won number 33, and I wore it because of him. And he was just like, man, he was this dude. I mean, you think about that Sky Hook, man, that was just unbelievable. You know, it won the most deadly shots ever to play. What I hated about the Lakers were that they were just so, at that time, you know, just, you just didn't, things about them you just didn't like, man. You just didn't like because that symbol on the side of that dude's hat right there. Oh, my God. And just the way they walked, or they came into a building. It's almost like they were, like they wanted to think that they were better than us. And that, I think, created that much more animosity because of who they were and just the way they walked into a building, man. It gives me the damn willies thinking about it right now. I mean, I'm looking at Michael Cooper on the screen, and he and I do podcasts now. We both have dueling podcasts. I've been on with him and James Worthy, and, you know, we talk about just some of the stuff and just the angst that we had for each other.
Yeah, who is – so for the younger viewers, can you bring us back to the 1983-84 season? I want to ask you, who was the best player in the league? Who was the alpha? Because Larry won the MVP, and he won it by a landslide. Magic finished second in voting. He only had one first-place vote. Larry Bird won the MVP. But was Kareem still kind of – the quote-unquote face of the league? You know, they were already kind of talking about him being the old guy on the court during all the, you know, pre-game interviews and post-game interviews. Or was it a guy like Moses Malone, who was, I guess, like the LeBron or Steph Curry or Giannis Antetokounmpo of the 83-84 season in this time?
Gentlemen, I hate to say this, but I'm looking at this. I love this fact where I was holding Magic, and he was just – and then he goes, he's holding me. He's up. Shut up.
Number one thing. That's my number one thing is, you know, if you're going to at least talk to me, not the ref.
Absolutely. I know he ain't talking to me like that. I'm just like, I mean, Magic was that dude, you know, that again, that you look at my alpha, and but we had a bunch of alphas. And the thing about the Lakers, again, was you could see the score. They built a nice little score on us, and we started getting back in the game. And we did it because we were starting to be a lot more physical, getting into the heads a little bit. And when you do that against a Laker team, later on you're going to probably see the famous clothesline that scared Kevin McHale more than anything else. But it's just crazy.
Yeah, this game I think is known for the Celtics comeback for sure. With a minute left, it goes into overtime. But I think the signature moment of this game, which we'll see later as we watch it, as we rewatch it, is got to be the Kevin McHale, Kurt Rambis clothesline, which is, you know, I think whenever the NBA Finals come around, like obviously the NBA Finals are happening right now, and they always show the, you know, highlights of finals in previous years. That's always one that comes up, and it just lives in NBA fans' minds all the time, because that is one of the signature moments of this game and just the finals in general.
Don't you love that there was a physical play in a game that is a signature play? Not a slam dunk, not anything like you and I. The three of us talked for a while. We talked about how the game is played, and you know, back then it was sometimes a little fisticuffs. Guys would get into it, and I loved animosity. The basketball NBA should never. There shouldn't. The physicality in the NBA should be a lot more than it is at Sports Fitness Club of LA. When I see guys play against each other, I mean, I want to see that. I want to see the animosity. I want to see the grit. I want to see the grind. I want to see guys and basketball to me is a psychological game. It's a game that you get into somebody else's head, and you get into somebody else's head because you can talk them out of their game. If you're a real player, you don't let nobody talk you out of the game. You just go, okay, all right, I'll see you in about 2 minutes, brother. Don't worry about it. It's going to happen.
Yeah, absolutely. And like we talked about earlier, you had that response to the report that Jerry West said James Worthy, who you were matched up with a lot, was already the finals MVP. You had responded to that. We know Larry Bird is an all-time trash talker. I wanted to ask you, was Larry like that in practice, or was he really only like that to his opponents? Was there ever a moment in practice or in camp where you looked at him and you said, wow, he really has no back down in him, or was he just with that with the opponents?
You know, you think about who he was, that he did talk a lot of noise, but there was more noise talk between myself and Robert Parrish and Dennis Johnson and Kevin McHale than anything else when you think about how the game is played and at that level. So Larry Bird wasn't the best trash talker. He talked a lot of noise. But I think it was also with the guys that he played with, and the fact that he, you know, you had to back it up. Man, this move right here, the James Worthy, that right there is a signature.
That's great.
Spin to the baseline, get there before anybody, and dunk the basketball. That's what made him so quick, and he was too quick, really, for Larry Bird to guard. But I was a little bit quicker, so I could maybe take that particular position away.
You know who James Worthy?
Here's the thing I love. Why in the world, in the finals game, would you have Kurt Rambis guarding me? Why? What the hell was that? I mean, really, really, Pat? This is what you want to do? This is how you want it? Okay. I'm going to serve you like they do it at Burger King and McDonald's right now. Okay.
I'm not a fan of rec specs, is what you're saying. if a man is rec specs matching up against you, it's like, yeah, it's an
that's
easy
barbecue
night.
Chicken.
Give me the ball.
It reminds me of when Jimmy Butler was, you know, talking all that mess when Grant Williams was guarding him. He was like, "Are you guys serious? This is the matchup you guys wanted." That was great.
He said, you know, the smirk, you know, of like, okay, here we go, you know, let's play this thing, you know. Jimmy did that with Grant, you know, recently. It was like, okay, right. Grant, you know, you want to play it like this, then let's go. I thought that was really interesting. I think that Miami Heat team, you know, is really showing that kind of mentality of what that can be, you know, when you're both so confident in yourself that you're unshakable. Plus, you know, physical wise, you know, they're really giving it. They're really a gritty team, I believe. With the current NBA Finals, I'm curious, do you think that Nikola Jokic has that mindset that's going to be kind of unshakable in these last few games? Because I think that, you know, so much of the Nuggets comes down to that with Jokic's mindset here.
Oh, Jokic is going to go at it, man. I love the fact who he was and what he could do. I mean, Jokic was that dude, man. And that he is, he comes from a war-torn country. So he doesn't give a damn one way or the other about what guys say. And I remember he was in he got into a little pushy match with one of the players. And the player said, well, you know, I'm going to get my brother and we're going to see Jokic. Jokic's brothers came back and said, oh, you want to do that? Okay, we can do that. So it was, I love his demeanor. And he doesn't seem like anything rattles him. So I can't see Jimmy Butler getting into his head and the thing where they say too small and all that stuff. It doesn't work out like that.
Too small, yeah. I mean, they have to choose someone else. I mean, maybe someone else in the Denver Nuggets, they could you know, exploit that. Because we did see, potentially with the Celtics, you know, that is a big thing of what everyone was saying was, you know, at the end of the day, the mentality, you know. And there were times where the Celtics didn't really seem ready for, you know, the mental challenge of a playoff game. They no-showed.
Yeah, I think that there were times, and this is what I like about the physicality of the game, which has to be there. You think about what guys are going to do and how they're going to play. I mean, you want to see guys battle in that way. And, you know, you get a chance to see how guys are going to get out and how they're going to play and how they're going to perform and what they do. I'm a big fan right now of guys playing at a high level and guys playing with energy. So I don't mind at all when I think about, you know, Jimmy Butler and what he's done. And, you know, just even the trash talking to me, that's so cool.
Oh yeah, definitely brings us back as Worthy gets a dunk on the break. You know, so I know you love that. So the Celtics and the Lakers, these were the two best teams during the regular season. You guys finished both first in each of your respective conferences. However, the Lakers did beat you guys in both regular season meetings. So I wanted to ask you, Max, like, going into this finals and now you're down 2-1 going into game four, were they at all? I think I know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it anyways for the viewers. Were they at all in your head a little bit because they had the edge in the regular season? They were up 2-1. They did blow you guys out in game three. So going into game four, did you guys feel like you had to prove it to yourselves that you can hang in the series? Or did you guys know, listen, we can still win this. We're fine. We just got to do our job, stay the course, and we're going to be all right.
Yeah, I think that you're spot on in the fact that James Worthy, they had us down. They won the first game. Second game in Boston, my guy Gerald Henderson steals the ball late in the game, ties the game up. We win it. We're fortunate to go back to L.A. right now, 1-1. And then we get there, get blown out. And we, to a man, in that game, we said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to be so physical that we're going to stop letting the Lakers have layups. We're going to take that away. And by not letting them have any more layups, it turned into, you know, this dude dribbling the ball right now, Magic, had to look both ways before he crossed the street. And he wasn't looking before. He's just running. After some clothesline, it was on and popping in. Good block by your boy. Whoever blocked that,
that was great.
Get that mess out of there.
And then how physical was Kareem out there? Because, you know, I feel like he has kind of a reputation as, you know, especially with the Skyhook, as someone who was a bit more finesse. But obviously to win so many MVPs and to be competing, as we're watching, you know, he's out here, you know, taking all the – it seems like he's taking all the physicality. And he certainly, I believe, punched someone in the face at one point. So, and broke his hand. So I'm curious how Kareem was battling against him in these NBA Finals matchups.
I mean, I said before, I think that Robert Parrish was one of Kareem's biggest fans. And I did on my podcast, I said, the thing I hated about him was the fact that you respected him too much. He said, man, that dude, I loved him. I loved what he did. You know, he was the ultimate. So when you think about him playing and what those two did was that Kareem was he was the passer. He was the alpha. He is, that's a, I love this play. Boom.
Get out of my way.
See, that's LA fake. That's fakeness right there. Knock him right on his ass. That was such a great play by him. You know, when you think about him, just what he did, that to me, that was crazy. Because here's Michael Cooper falling back as if somebody had just hit him in the head with a baseball bat. Come on, man. Play the game the right way. Stop being all that. It's, okay, Larry's here.
Here it is.
Here's Cooper. Cooper's standing here. Gets behind. He's out of bounds right
he
now.
He pushed him.
And now he wants to tumble over these people. Are you serious? He didn't even. You want to get that replay back? You know, is that Joel Embiid right now falling back and forth with that fake stuff? Is that who that is? Really, is that who that was? Or maybe Joel Embiid back then, you know, just falling down. So I mean, you know, I'm glad you guys have me before dinner, and I haven't eaten yet, so it's gonna be hard to stomach some of this food going down thinking about these dudes.
That's another signature moment of this game. But back to Kareem. So, like you said, Chief was guarding him. He obviously was matched up with him, and like you said, he admired him. But I actually feel like Chief did a good job in this series. Kareem shot under 50%, which in this series, which for Kareem, that's low. He shot 48%, but he was, you know, a 55-60% shooter. So for you guys to get him under that 50% mark, did you guys feel like, obviously you guys won the series, right? So mission accomplished, but did you feel like you contained Kareem in a way? Because he was such a great player, you weren't going to stop him, but did you feel like you contained him and you limited the damage that he was able to do?
Yeah, we did. Because Kareem's one of the all-time greats. You know, when it comes to scoring the ball and what he's able to do, I mean, he's unreal. So for us to play against Kareem and to have him below his average, that was so cool. Them going out of the locker room, going to their locker room, here they are again. Here's this cheesy look of them coming out and walking, and just so, it was so cool. I can't wait for this third quarter, man. I cannot wait just to see.
Well, what was the halftime speech like?
Turned on one particular play.
What was it down 10 here? Fast break points again, but Los Angeles is looking 20, just like last game. What was said in the locker room here by anyone?
That we were okay, that we needed to play harder, and we needed to be a lot more physical. Now, this is, I love this, one of the all-time greats, Tommy Heinsohn on the microphone right now,
doing play-by-play.
And you know he had to be biased. Look, my Laker guy's just shaking his head like, I can't believe they had Tommy up there.
No, Tommy, I love Tommy.
I'm glad I'm on this side. I will say no. I'm glad I'm on the no. I'm glad I'm with the good guys. Is that how we called it? Yeah, the good guys.
No, I love Tommy. Good, as he got
guys, yeah.
There are good guys and then there's the evil guys. That's what we call that.
No, I love Tommy Heinsohn. As he got older, he definitely got more biased, but I respected it. He stayed true to his heart. But in the pregame for this game, he was actually he was very good. I love Dick Stockton as well, who he was commentating with. But Tommy Heinsohn, before this game, they were talking about Magic, and Tommy Heinsohn looks into the camera, and he just say, quite frankly, Magic has been kicking dust in the face of the Celtic players. So Tommy knew that you guys had to slow down the Showtime Lakers, like you mentioned earlier. So the fast break difference, I mean, 20 points. I feel like you guys did contain the Lakers' fast breaks because, you know, in game three, they obviously, you told this earlier, you didn't even feel like they inbounded the ball. You felt like they just took it from under the hoop and were just going.
In game three, I swear I wish we could have seen footage. I don't think they took the ball out of bounds. Magic was right behind me. I'm saying, what the heck is going on here? I mean, their break was incredible. So to see it in this game and us to slow them down, and this game becomes, you can see this game becomes more of a slog than anything else. this game was sort of slow down. Here's Magic running again, and you know, just want to slow him down just a little bit, but we did what we needed to do when it came to rebound the basketball and, you know, just playing with some guts, man, some guts and courage. And that to me, that's what that meant.
Right, because you guys didn't want to play their game. You guys were actually the two best offenses in the league. The Lakers were number one, I believe, and you guys were right there second. But to go into a finals matchup with the number one offense and be like, we got to outscore them, that's just not the right game plan. So to take them out of their flow a little bit was the right call by you guys. And obviously, you know, it worked. Unfortunately, I should say, but fortunately for you. But yeah, that definitely was the right game plan.
Did you, excuse me?
Unfortunately, first of all, first of all, at this point, Jared, I'm going to step in. You are a fan. This man's life. So, you know, unfortunately.
What did this man just say? Unfortunately?
Unfortunately, he's sitting with
him. I can't lie to you and make it look fly to you, okay? That's all I got to say. I mean, I don't want people to come out and tell me and take me out.
You just got carried away then. Whatever happened, you just got carried away. But what they're doing, the Lakers are daring us to take jump shots. These jump shots the Celtics are taking right now are probably at the elbow. And we dare the Lakers because you got to realize the game during that time, the game was more about just the passing and it was about scoring in the paint. You know, you look at the NBA now, that's how it's changed. And the fact that guys don't run towards getting layups, they run towards the three-point line because they want to get three-pointers. I was involved in the first three-point play. Chris Ford, God bless his soul, passed away recently. He shot the first three-pointer in the history of the NBA and forever changed the NBA. They were already doing the ABA, but when he did that, the game changed. And I don't know if it's changed for the best because the floor is a lot more wide open. I take nothing away from Steph Curry. But Steph Curry probably has destroyed the game more than anybody. In fact, he's so damn good, and everybody else tries to do what Steph Curry does, and you can't because he's that good of a scorer.
Right. My biggest takeaway watching these historical games is that, you know, when it was harder to get by people because the game was a lot more in the paint, and there was just kind of a wall that you had to penetrate. Now, I mean, the help defense is just not there because everyone's trying to stick to shooters. When I watch a game like this, you know, it's like, even if you get by your initial defender, you're getting met by two, three guys at the rim. So it was a lot more physical. And we're not just talking about hard fouls. It's just you have to navigate through more guys while you're trying to get to the rim. You look at the game now, Jimmy Butler beats one guy, and, you know, that's pretty much it. It's him between the rim, and there's no one else.
Dude, it was real tough basketball at the time. It was really tough at the time when, you know, the physicality of what guys did. And now, you just said, you knew you had some real moves, man. If you were able to score in the NBA at that time in the paint, essentially it was almost like scoring in a doggone elevator. You know, you think about it, just guys were, you have five guys in the elevator and you had to beat these five guys. Look at Kareem, just pissed off, running down the floor because he didn't want to get back because he got fouled. Really, God forbid Kareem Abdul-Jabbar got fouled. Oh, yeah, are you kidding me? Come on.
As a teammate of a Chief, did you have to bring out, you know, that mentality in him? I think you kind of alluded to it earlier. You know, you obviously said that he admired Kareem. A lot of you guys did. Kareem was an icon, you know. But did you have to go up to Chief and be like, that guy, you have to destroy that guy. You have to, you know, not stand up against him in a way, but you have to be competitive with him, stop admiring him? Or was that something that Chief found in himself?
You know what? Chief found out in himself, but he also had his teammates saying, dude, this is what you have to do. You have to go at these guys. You cannot allow a guy like Kareem to get comfortable in the paint. And you can see the Celtics slowly getting back in this game because we're a lot more physical. And we had said that.
Right.
Going into the locker room. No, James, come on, Kareem. God forbid.
I think he got
blow on the guy. Damn, just give him a foul. I mean, you think about the NBA now, Kareem, to me, again, this is no disrespect because he's my all-time, one of my all-time favorites. But, man, he was crying like Jason Tatum cries sometimes. And sometimes it drives me crazy. Every play, you're not going to get a call. Every play, you're not going to get a call. Oh, Kevin McHale is in this game. It's about to happen. I'm loving this. I can actually feel it, the animosity. You're at the, and here's the thing I love. Essentially what it was, when Kurt Rambis went down, the beautiful thing about it, it was almost like 20 guys, 20 basketball players. Now I knew what it was like when Custer was there. It was like 20 guys against all the people who were there attacking him. And we just had to deal with their animosity and what they felt. And I loved it. We gathered around as a team and we felt a certain way, and we were going to make that. That was going to be our last stand. And we knew it. They knew it. And we knew we had to win this basketball game.
So you felt like that moment brought you together in that and right away?
Absolutely. It galvanized us and made us play harder. And it told them that, dude, you might come and things might happen, but boy, we are coming at you. It doesn't make any difference. We are coming at you right now. And Magic Johnson, who was flying down the lane and, you know, got the head going and all that stuff. And you look at him, oh, there I go. I'm pissed off about something. But Magic Johnson flying down the lane, you know, think of Magic. He was going and he never even looked. He was like a kid crossing the street and never looking at traffic. When that happened, and when Kurt Rambis went down, you're talking about a break that went to a slow break, to a slow crawl? Oh, that's what I loved. Kevin McHale, who never passed, ended up passing back to DJ. I can't believe that. Uh-oh.
Here it is.
Ooh.
Oh. Man. Uh-oh. You know, every time you watch
Larry Bird with the
It doesn't get softer.
He's backing away. He didn't. It scared him. It scared the heck out of him. He didn't mean to do it. But you can see it. Once he grabbed him, he was grabbing almost to hold him. And then Kurt Rambis runs towards him. Kevin McHale is running away. So it wasn't like we had our toughest guy. But what it did was galvanize everybody. Now Pat Riley's out there. Guys talking noise. The animosity is ranking. It's going up to the you can tell all the testosterone is just going up now. Guys right now are getting more and more pissed off, and I love every moment of it. Casey Jones. Then you got Pat Riley all the way down. Both teams. Look at all these Laker fans, all these Faker fans. Oh, I mean, maybe say that out loud. All these fans. And here it is right here. The fast break running down. You watch Kevin McHale. Kevin McHale grabs him. He doesn't mean necessarily to throw him down. He grabbed him and just hit him around the neck. And Kurt Rambis jumps up. And Kevin McHale, instead of doing whatever, he's backing away. So it was that was some cool stuff. And you could tell that the gang was here. And it's about to be on and popping from here on in.
Oh, yeah. The intensity is about to ramp up for sure. And, you know, Rambis did what he did. You know, he had to retaliate. He didn't know what happened in the moment for sure, like you just said. But, you know, he did his job. Everyone did their job. Everyone had each other's back. And, yeah, that
Rambis,
I mean, every
tried.
Time you watch
Rambis
it,
tried
that,
to run. I don't even know. Like, watch Rambis just – he just gets – James Worthy, I think, bodied him out. So, you know, if anything, Worthy took out Rambis.
Can't believe
it. Imagine being that photographer.
Somebody help
us. What were you all saying after this, as this was happening? Was anyone talking specifically?
A whole lot of nothing, I bet.
Absolutely. Everybody was screaming over there. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about. Now, Kurt, can you – Kurt steps
Ball don't lie. See?
Here, but you could tell now that it was ramping up. The only thing I didn't see was the police force out there, because it was about to be on and popping from here on in. Game slows down a little bit more. Magic starts a little bit more, a lot more animosity. And Bird getting a little jump shot here, missing. But we get back on the break. We slow Magic down a little bit. We got guys attacking. playing the right way. Great job by Gerald. And here's my man. Great job.
DJ.
Attacking the ring, going right towards the rim. And the defense picks up. And I want to start chanting now. I'm looking at my Laker guy now. He's like, oh, I can see they're getting back in this thing. Bring it on.
Yeah,
bring it on. Our defense has picked up a little bit more. And they go to Kareem as usual. I like that.
What was DJ like? Because I feel like he's one of the more underrated point guards in history. You know, he was a finals MVP when he played for the Sonics. He comes to Boston, and he's your starting point guard right away. Mm-hmm. This guy, like I said, I think he's one of the most underrated guys. So if you could tell the viewers, the younger viewers, and myself, because he's kind of been lost in the history, because we always talk about great point guards, right? And there's all these lists, right? Magic's one of them, you know. But DJ, I feel like, gets lost. So what was he like as a player and also like a teammate off the court?
Great guy. You know, he was one of my favorites. He and I did this thing. I thought it was so funny that they used to have this magazine that was called Rob Report. And in Rob Report, what they did, Rob Report used to have these huge homes all over the country. And we would call a realtor. We would go to their homes and look at these homes. We weren't buying the homes. We were just being nosy. So we'd go there to these homes and, you know, and see these different places and just like, so he was like my main guy, Walter Mathis. You can just see the people. That was the cool thing about it. You also saw the people who were on the sideline watching the games, the Laker games. That was some good stuff. I like that. I think that was the best. That dude right there, Jack Nicholson, he became a friend of the family. And we all loved him. Wow. Because you remember, we were traveling back and forth in commercial flights at that time. And Jack Nicholson was one of the few people got in first class with us. And that was so cool.
Nice. Yeah, huge fan of the game. Jack's a legend.
So he transcended the rivalry due to those plane flights.
I love this. Oh my God, this is it.
There it is.
Yes, Larry just jumps right back up in his face, and oh yeah, it is on. And Kareem is talking about kicking somebody's ass, and look, he's throwing elbows, it's heating up. It is heating up. My favorite player in the game is now over the top with just emotion. And it took away from what they were doing. Because when you're in LA, as you know, LA guy, you're cool. Everything's cool. You know, you just get there, you're on Rodeo Drive, you go to Santa Monica, you know, you go here, you go there. Everything is so cool. It's great. Come back out east and watch the same thing happen. Now, what do you see here other than Kareem throwing the elbow? What do you see? And he's pissed off at Larry as he throws the elbow.
Ooh. Yeah, you know, I think
you would have threw Kareem out of this game. You think about
right.
it. He would have been thrown out of this game. He would have been thrown out of the game for the elbow. Kevin McHale would have been out of the game. So, you know, a lot of guys, the new NBA, if you put this tape right now and make some of these guys watch the NBA, who are in the NBA right now, watch this and they go, oh my God. My guy Rick Mahorn sent a tape of himself fouling me. It was a flagrant 6, not a flagrant 2. And you know, he hit me in the head and then he just stood over me. I was like,
yeah.
And so it was that kind of stuff, man, that you think about. And guys now complain when they get tapped or they get hit. And I'll use this word in a very polite way. I know we have kids, but this was grown-ass man basketball. That's what happened in this game.
Well, there's a difference. You know, we agreed there was a difference, you know, between, I would say, you know, the actual fighting and a physical rivalry, you know, where you both are really going at it. I just think that there's a big difference. And, yeah, I feel like somewhere along the way we've gotten a bit tangled in that, and where it's like you can see right here, you know, there is not that fighting aspect, but there is that physical aspect that is leading to really, I'd say, top level competition, because we're watching Bird, you know, go at it now versus Kareem in a way that they just weren't. There's an added layer.
Yeah, man, that's the good stuff right there. You think about what guys are doing and where they want the ball. Give me that ball on that baseline.
You don't like that call. You know, I think it speaks to your mental toughness. Like, you know, this game is an example, right, of what made the Celtics, you, Larry, all the guys special, is that when the game would get heated like this, you guys seem to really, you know, rise to the occasion, whereas the Lakers seem to kind of, you know, like you mentioned earlier, you know, they wanted everything cool, chill, right? And they wanted to be flashy. They were the Showtime Lakers. You guys almost were like, you know, we want to dig our heels in. We want to get dirty a little bit. We, you know, we don't mind getting a little, you know, mud on our face. So I think this is a perfect example of that. You know, mental toughness isn't, you know, who's barking at each other in the moment. It's, you know, after that, who could really just keep their composure and, you know, come out with and execute to win the game, and which, you know, in this example, you guys did.
Well, I mean, that is what real players do. Here's Larry Bird with a great steal in the baseline, and Gerald misses the jump shot. But these are the little moments that you see in a game that we were just trying to get there and get over the hump, and we just felt we had them, but we just kept missing these little snowbirds. But rest assured, we're clawing back in this thing, man. Where's big game at right now? I don't see big game right now. Great block.
Yeah, I'll give credit to Kareem. I mean, Kareem, on at least for the Lakers, is, you know, really coming at it, demanding the ball. But so you're saying James Worthy, we're about to watch him wilt away. He is not in the version of himself yet that's ready for this.
Oh man, look at this on the sideline. When you have Quincy Jones on the sideline, man, these guys were there watching me play, and I've seen them as musicians playing. Come on, man, that's incredible. Cool.
Who was the biggest starstruck moment you had? You know, whether it was in LA or New York, wherever, where you were like, "Wow, like, look, that person came to watch us play."
Wow, that's pretty good. I think one time Michael Jackson was at the game, which was so
cool. I had a feeling that was going to be the answer.
I don't think good anything was going on in the game, but just the fact he was there was so cool.
That's wow, crazy. That's really
cool. Those are just slowly reeling them back in, guys, like fishing at the Santa Monica Pier, man. We're reeling their ass back in. All right, come on back in, Lakers. Come on back in, Fakers.
So Max, I forget who said this. I think it was in the Winning Time documentary on ESPN. Somebody said this. I wish I remember who, but they said that Pat Riley, his alter ego was Showtime. You know, the flashy, you know, glitz and glam. Pat Riley, in his core, in his heart, he was a blue-collar, tough-working kind of guy. You know, I know it was impossible for you to know that then, you know, in 1984, but did you have any sense of, hey, Pat Riley, he's a really gritty guy, or did you just think, oh, he's a Michael Douglas-looking guy, he's slick, he's suave, he's wearing Armani, he's got the hair back, or did you kind of see the blue-collar grit that he had? Because remember when he went to New York, he showed that. But in LA, this was his alter ego. Yeah.
I don't think that was on display as much when he was in LA, because he was that. He had the Armani suit, had the hair going, had the, you know, all the cool stuff going on with him. So no, you didn't get a chance to see that until later on. But if you think about it now, Jimmy Butler is Pat Riley's alter ego. Oh. He's what Pat Riley, who he is. Grit, determination, get in your face. Like I said, I went to speak to Pat Riley. I told you guys a little bit earlier. Went to speak to him at the Garden, you know, before when he's with the Heat. Tells me, you know, get out of here, you damn jinx. I'm like, really? Seriously? you want it like that, buddy? I'm good right now. We got to take this thing to a cage match. It'll be two 60-year-old men. He's 70, probably fighting each other. That would have been fine with me. I'd have been cool with that.
Yeah, and on the flip side, what was Casey Jones like as a coach? You know, he's another guy that I feel like, you know, when you talk about great coaches, we're talking Phil Jackson, Popovich, you know, Pat Riley always comes up. And I just feel like those guys are a little bit more expressive. They were just a little bit more, you know, in the media. Whereas Casey Jones, you know, he was a coach. He was a great coach. So if you could tell us a little bit about Casey Jones, what was he like as a coach?
Casey Jones was quiet and he was determined.
Perfect.
And the thing you loved about him, his position as a player, as a coach, he understood fully. And this is, I love this, Kareem and Magic. Kareem right now being guarded by Larry Bird. And these little plays right here tell you what it's like. Dennis Johnson coming off. This was a real team game. And every time the Lakers kind of got going, we bring them back. They got going, we bring them back. It's like not having a sale on Rodeo Drive. That's how we were doing them. No. We're bringing you guys back. Every shot you make, we're going to come back and make a shot too.
So I did want to ask you, we had mentioned before the...
Did you say ooh then when Larry hit that shot?
Yeah, you know...
I was going to ask about Larry. Because like we had mentioned that Larry somehow in practice though wasn't... Because you said that, you know, he was a trash talker, but it didn't seem like he was on the level, you know... When Michael Jordan is regarded as, you know, a top tier trash talker, right? And then when we hear Michael Jordan's teammates talk about him, they're bringing up random stories about how like Jordan bought a pool table to just get better at them at pool just because they lost to him one time. You know, so Larry, I'm curious because he has some of the all-time trash talk stories. Like he has the went to the three-point contest, said who's playing for second. He has he has with Chuck Person. He went up to him and said, I have a Christmas gift for you, and then made a three in his face in the middle of the game and said, Merry effing Christmas. Larry had those kind of things. So I'm curious, was Larry that kind of guy that would trash talk to maybe hype himself up more in that kind of way? Because I feel like that's his trash talk more motivates himself.
Yeah, I think he was. I think to motivate himself and to get in the heads of the opposition. You know, he just wanted to play, and he wanted to play, and he wanted to play hard. But if you were weak-minded, that's the thing that he was so good at, of getting into your head, man. There was a young Byron Scott. This is the greatness of this game. I'm looking at the players who are walking on the floor right now. Byron Scott coming in off the bench. Byron Scott was one of the all-time greats to me. You got Magic. Got Kevin McHale. Look at the Hall of Famers that played in this game. That's what's so crazy about it. You got Robert Parrish, you got Kevin McHale, you got Larry Bird, and you got Dennis Johnson. Four guys who are in the Hall of Fame for the Celtics already. Then you look at the other side. Magic, Worthy, Kareem, I think Jamal Wilkes was in it. So that's eight guys right now in the Hall of Fame. I'm probably missing somebody. And then you had all the ancillary players like myself and Michael Cooper. But, man, just the talent level. This is what I love. Dennis Johnson getting up, riding Magic like a pony. I love that. Kareem with that skyhook, nobody. This is where we knew we had them right here. They weren't that cockiness, that attitude that you look at the score going, damn, okay, wait a minute. Where's the showtime? We're happy, Magic, high five, and all this. No. The game right now, 88-90, we're right in their behinds right now.
You know, I think if you were to show this game to someone who doesn't know the context of it, you know, that you guys were, you know, down in this series, I think if you just show this game, game four, I think a lot of people would say it looks like the Lakers are down in this series because, like you mentioned earlier, they were kind of losing their cool a little bit. All those things that – all the retaliations that we've seen so far in the game had come from L.A.'s side, which usually in a series, that's the team who needs it more, who's a little bit more desperate, who needs the win more. You guys actually, remarkably, you guys look like the team that has a 2-1 lead and is on the road trying to stay in the game that the Lakers have to win. So – it's really interesting when you watch this game without knowing who's up because it looks like you guys are the winning team.
Well, right now you can see that Matt is being guarded tight and everything. And Byron Scott played pretty good. Played pretty good in another game. And we just couldn't contain him for a while.
But was this he a is rookie in this season? I'm trying to think.
So you played, I believe, 40 minutes in this game. Was fatigue a factor at this point?
Nope.
Nope, not at all. You're able to just not push through.
Not when you're playing for your basketball life. You don't. There's nothing in. Look, here's the thing about it. You're playing right now in the Forum, and the Forum had air conditioning. We played in the Garden, where we played them in, I think, want to say Game 5, and the temperature back east at that day was something crazy in Boston. It was like 100 degrees, but in the building, it was 115. So, how are you? You're not fatigued like this. You're playing. It's 75 degrees in your building or whatever it is. So there was no fatigue factor at all. But this is how the game got a little bit better, because Magic Johnson was being guarded right now by one guy in particular. Give me that. And Dennis Johnson did an excellent job of staying up on Magic.
So when LeBron was in Miami playing San Antonio, and they were in San Antonio and the AC mysteriously ended up breaking, you had no hard feelings for that. You didn't feel bad for those guys, right?
AC. Dude, most basketball players have played outside all their lives, especially guys who live down south. And you play the temperature is in the 90s, humidity is 100, and you're talking about getting tired? And there wasn't anything like Gatorade. It was like, hurry up and get to the water fountain, and the water fountain was always not cool. It was lukewarm. So you summon up what you did when you were a child, when you're a young kid, and you played that way.
For sure. With Julius Erving in the past, when you guys matched up against him, you had a specific defensive strategy I'd read where basically you were, dropping off of him a few feet, I believe, to negate his athleticism in that way. Was there a strategy that you had going in against Magic as a team? Because I know you're hyping up DJ right now for doing a defensive job on him. But, right now, really stopping the two stars, it feels like, is going to get you this win to begin the quarter.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about it, we wanted to become Magic. When he first got in the league, he wasn't a shooter. He wasn't a standstill shooter. Then he became a standstill jump shooter. And, the Lakers right now getting a little happy to go up by four, but guarantee you, you start reeling these guys in, man. You start playing with that kind of oomph, man. And this is the pushing. This is where they want to get a little edgy. And no longer playing Laker basketball. They're playing Celtic basketball. Look at the chippiness now. Both guys right now gunning up each other. Byron Scott on one side, Henderson. They're going back and forth. Now, here's the thing I love about this. Neither one of these guys can jump. So I know Larry's just going to jump into him. I mean, the Magic is not a Leaf friend. And then, the same thing. Dennis Johnson did a great job of just understanding and of playing this game. And Sweden Nader, who was a real good rebounder in this league, didn't play as much, but he's trying to give Kareem a couple of minutes here.
Yeah, I thought that was an interesting adjustment here. I think Pat Riley and Casey Jones were in a game of chicken here, and he forced Pat Riley to play him, to get a little bit more rebounding physicality. And maybe it was because Kareem was a little tired and banged up. Like we alluded to earlier, he was a little bit older in the season. I think if Pat Riley had his way, he wouldn't have to play him. But, the game, took its course, and he had to find extra minutes for Kareem.
Man, it just tickles me when you think about this game and playing at this level, and you see guys running each other, trying to take charges, getting hit with the basketball, and the game gets more and more and more intense. And you could tell as you got there, you start looking at this score, as Larry looks up at it going, we got these dudes. We have got these dudes, and we're going to play at a full level. And man, this is what really was the really, look at this is pure holding right here. And obviously look at Magic. He's jumping back. Somebody trying to steal his wallet or something. It's like, come on, man. Are you serious?
A lot is always made up of, you know, the leadership of a superstar, right? Someone like Larry Bird. I'm curious, was Larry someone who you guys would look to in that way? Or do you think that, you know, because you had such incredible talent all around the roster that you guys all really just picked yourselves up?
Larry was a great guy to look to, but at the same time, you think about the game, you know, for the Celtics. There was only one guy who was the Finals MVP, and that was me.
Mm-hmm.
So during that particular time, so, you know, guys looked up to me. Guys looked up to those guys who had played at a high level.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, that's the complete sense that I'm getting is that, you know, you guys really were a team in that highest sense. There really wasn't, you know, one guy that, you know, really all of you. Also, you are considered one of the greatest, this 1984 Celtics team, one of the greatest teams of all time. Does that hold a special place to you when you're, you know, as NBA history continues to go, that you guys are regarded so highly?
The history of the game, I loved it. That point, that play right there where I hit Magic with a little forearm shiver.
Yeah. Oh, he traveled too.
Just think about it. Every time I hit somebody, I'm looking at that Laker hat. He just gets more and more intense. Like, what happened here? Why'd they call a foul?
He's an emotional connection himself.
Yeah, no, I actually enjoy the no call, but like, yes. It frustrates me because, like, in today's game, that's a call. So when you go back and watch it, you know, your knee-jerk reaction is like, oh, blow the whistle. But then you're like, no, the game's better when it's more physical, like we talked about. But then also Magic traveled on that. So I feel like you fouled him, he traveled, and the ref was just like, well, whatever, it cancels each other out, keep playing. Dude, and the pace of the game just kept going.
Yeah, at that point, the referees just let it go, man. They could feel the intensity in the game. And then you can see some of the free throws. Kareem starts to miss them a little bit. And, you know, it's just slowly but surely, you know, the veil was just kind of coming off, man. Because Kareem one of the pure big man shooters at the free throw line. So it was just, you know, we could see it. We could see it. And we could smell it. Now who is going to do what? That's what it's going to boil down to now. Give to my man Chief on the baseline. Nice little 15-footer. Ah! Yes, I love it. Whew.
But is there any NBA player in today's game that reminds you of yourself? You know, for the younger viewers who might have not been able to watch, you know, your career or your play style, is there anybody that reminds you? Or do you feel like you were just, you know, your own thing and maybe your game was for your era and didn't really, you know, cross over to the current era? What are your thoughts on that?
You know, I hate to say this because, you know, has some few words going at each other in the playoffs, but, you know, Draymond Green, who's a passer, you know, very much like myself, who thinks the game in a big way. I like what he brings to the table. So he's a guy that I look at and going, yeah. And then I always say, look at also guys who played in the league now, and I'm thinking, could you have played in the NBA during the 80s? I always think about the guy that I look at and I laugh about is Marcus Smart. Marcus Smart is physical enough right now to play in the 80s. Some guys like, Dame Lillard, tough as he is, playing during the 80s. You got a lot of guys. Jimmy Butler would have been absolutely unreal to play with this attitude during the 80s. Now, with some of the junk that he was talking, would he take a butt whooping? Yeah, he would have. But you know, there's 80s basketball, and man, you're talking about guys just wanting to go at it. That's juicy stuff, man. Okay, that's what I'm talking about.
Well, Jimmy Butler grew up as a basketball player, at least as a professional, in that Bulls culture, and he was quoted as saying that when he was watching, you know, MVP Derrick Rose and how he was treated by Noah and Boozer and those guys, you know, they didn't care at all. They're like, Rose, you know, get your ass in practice. You know, you better be, you know, given 100%. There was not a single, you know, anything given to the MVP. So that was what Jimmy Butler saw as a rookie. I think he's really shown as a vet.
That's great stuff, man. And then here's Magic. Here's Kareem. And here's Worthy feeling like he got fouled, so he's, you know, he's throwing his arms all over. But man, this is when all the rubber hits the road here, making Magic become a shooter. Uh-oh, those shots right now, not as easy as the game's getting closer, Mr. Lakers.
So
DJ, wow. To start this game,
stream of trash talk happening at this point in the game with this much
Is there what in the game?
Is there still trash talk happening? Like, are the guys that in the beginning of the game were, you know, giving it, you know, in the post, like, you know, here we go. Are they still talking, or is it more locked in?
Yeah, there's still animosity. There's still a lot of talking. Mm-hmm. I think guys are focusing a little bit more as Robert Parrish picks up his fifth foul. One of the stories I had, I think about, is when Kareem, when it was one day we were playing against the Lakers. This is how, you know, it was. Playing against the Lakers in L.A., a game, and I'm taking the ball out. I got three or four Laker players who are on the bench screaming and yelling at me, talking a lot of noise. And the referee's about to give me the basketball. I said, hold on a minute. He looked at me like, what? I said, Pat Riley's standing beside me. I said, Pat, do me a favor. Put one of those guys in down there in the game. I called him some choice words. Pat put him in the game. And man, that was so nice. I scored on this guy about three or four times. And I said, the next time you're at the game and you got a free ticket like those guys at the end of the bench, you might want to shut your damn mouth because they might put you in the game. But Pat Riley was such a cool moment for me. I ended up telling Pat about that. And here's Danny Ainge, who was one of babyface Danny that everybody ended up hating. But Danny Ainge was a player, read our back in the audience, right, you know, in this game. This was just good, high quality stuff. And you can see this game tightening up just a little bit. I love this. You know, this is when, you know, okay, are we going to be men or boys here? My guy, Bob McAdoo, I loved him. But Bob McAdoo walks. And you can see the Laker. Look at that bitch now. And here's my guy, ML Carr, up cheering us on. We feel the momentum right now. Has swung our way. And you look at the Laker bench, and everybody is kind of sitting down right now, waiting for the next shoe to fall.
Yeah, you know, growing up watching the Lakers and Kobe, you know, that was my guy. My favorite moments watching Kobe's career was always on the road. One game in particular, I think it was game three in Boston. That was a game that, you know, the Lakers ended up losing, but Dwayne Wade was just on the sideline, just absolutely disgusted with how Kobe was playing. He was on fire. But my point is, my favorite moments were always on the road. You know, the home games are the home games, but when you're able to go into an opposing arena and really just stick it to 20,000 people, those are the best moments. So I can already tell you relish those moments as well. I know the Garden was a great special place, but to go to the Forum and do something like this, I know that sticks with you for your whole life, for sure.
Dude, to send 20,000 people home sad?
Yes.
Can't get any better than that.
So that was better? Crazy? It was better to end on the silence than the cheers? 20,000
people going home pissed off?
Oh, yeah.
Celtic bitch just standing up. We feel like we kind of, you know, galloping back on their heels a little bit here. But think about
Kareem
that.
Passing, Kareem, like you said.
An unbelievable passer, man. Unbelievable passer. So he could pass that basketball. And then they're daring Dennis Johnson, the guys right now, to take shots. Robert Parris getting in the middle and Larry Bird being grabbed and they're trying to run and no
that was great.
So but there's Bird, you know, yeah.
More physical.
Ooh.
Larry deep one.
Oh. So at the time, what Larry Bird, I think, described his three-point shot as kind of like a weapon in a way, because it was such a rare occurrence for them to even be, you know, shots going in. It was kind of like such a momentum changer. Do you feel like he was looking for those kind of shots in these moments, or just, you know, playing the game?
I think he was looking for those shots. Larry looked for the dagger. And, you know, a lot of guys are afraid to shoot that particular shot. Larry's never had that in his gene. He is always like, okay, if this shot has to be taken, it's like Michael said it before. He said, I've failed more than I have succeeded. And that to me was the the big thing you think about of, you know, of playing the game at that level. It's like, okay, what are we going to do, and how is it going to be? Great time out here by KC as you see the momentum, and ML Carr still, like, you know, trying to rev guys up, and the Laker fans getting all hyped as usual. But these people were about to go home sad. That was that's the best thing about it. When you can make kids cry, that was the best thing about it. And we would laugh because we would tell teams, like, we go up when we were really rolling, we play, have some guy behind the bench, and we go up by 10 points or something. First thing we say, take your wife and take your kids and beat the traffic, because this game is over right now.
Oh, man.
We're going to lose.
Yeah, and Red had.
Loved it.
Red was lighting the cigar? Was he still doing that in his?
Absolutely. I'm sure he did. In game seven, lit the cigar up when we beat the Lakers in game seven in Boston. That's some good stuff. Now the Celtics need a basket here. So let me see, what do we go to and how do we operate? Gerald Henderson giving Gerald a shot and can't put it down. And Lakers kind of smell it a little bit. And we have to make, the Celtics have to make some defensive plays here to step here, up here a little bit on the Lakers.
Oh, ooh. Wow.
Yeah.
You know, Max, you're just talking about Larry Bird. Does it bother you? Because I know it bothers me when people bring up Larry Bird now and they say, you know, he wasn't that great of a three-point shooter, and they bring up the numbers. You know, I think he shot under 40%, which people use as a benchmark. But for me, it was just like, you know, this basketball we're watching, you guys work from the inside out. The three-point and the outside shot was the shot you kind of took when – you know, all your other stuff wasn't there and the other team blew up your actions. You would take the outside shot, you know, yeah. As kind of not a last, kind of like a last resort. So does it bother you when people bring up, like, oh, Larry Bird actually wasn't a great 3-point shooter? Because to me, he's one of the best of all time. He just didn't take that many because you guys didn't value that shot in that
era. It wasn't the weapon that it turned out to be later on. So right. I think guys had to play at that level of, you know, running the floor and getting high percentage shots. And, you know, you got my guy, just Bob McAdoo, just missed a very easy jump shot. And the Lakers' legs getting a little bit heavier. Arms getting a little bit heavier.
See, Larry crashing.
Oh, yeah. No,
yeah. Offensive rebound for it. You know, exactly.
Here's what they needed. They needed a Red Bull right now. And didn't have
yeah, I mean, guy taking
the ball. There was none.
That's a Euro step before there was a Euro step.
Well, that's what I've always, like, respected about Larry. One of the most things, you know, growing up, reading about the NBA, watching the NBA, you know, is that Larry was always the kind of guy that if his shot wasn't falling, he was crashing the boards. He was playing defense. He was passing. Mm-hmm. He wasn't someone who's going to let that affect him. So it's incredible to see as we get to the down here.
Here's the thing you think about in this game. We miss a shot. Larry gets fouled. Celtics are down by 6. Does Kareem foul out of this game here?
I'm not sure. There's Larry fighting for that board against Kareem. You know, like, this is an all-time 7-foot giant center.
But Larry had great timing, and he had great hands. This time, able to get inside out, get the basketball against Kareem, and, you know, make it a little bit closer. Lakers could smell this. They were right on the verge, but our will. Oh, well, they're sending this guy back in the game. That's one reason something happened. Some Maxwell kid coming back in. Some good karma is about to happen.
Was there any
stat line on Larry? 21 so, points, 20 rebounds.
Incredible.
Mm-hmm.
As we get to the winning time portion of the game, was there anything that you guys, not scared isn't the right word, but, you know, when you watch, like, I think a lot of teams, when they play against LeBron, they're like, I hope he doesn't post up down below. Like, please don't do it. You know, there's certain things where, you know, you guys rather them not do. Was there anything that you guys didn't want the Lakers to do in this moment?
I think just getting the ball to Kareem for easy shots right now. Got me guarding Magic. I'm just going to try to push and get up on his body, try to create situations where what the hell was that? I know they didn't call a foul then.
Would you guys prefer if Magic was going towards the middle or towards the baseline?
Are you fucking serious? Are you
kidding? Yeah, I don't know what that was. Out of everything?
What the hell was that? Did I blow a kiss in the guy's ear or something? Please. How was that a foul?
Is there free throws under 2 minutes? Is that because I know they changed?
No, there's no free throws here. That wasn't that here? Yeah. Particular time. I don't think that ruling was in. So I think they're just taking the ball back out of bounds. But here he is. You want to make me sick again? Yep. Dancing Barry comes in.
I don't know. Pretty intimidating.
I love LA. Oh my goodness. You want to piss this up? The faithful. So now we're talking in the huddle. Talking about what we have to do. We need a stop. We need a stop here. And that's what it boils down to. They're up right now by 3 with 1:34. It's kind of in their hands. But, it's like, okay, all right, we're here. Still here. All we have to do is get a good defensive stop here.
Absolutely.
Keep it close on the road. That's the mission, right? Because you don't expect to go on the road and blow anybody out. You just need to keep it close, and Lakers make a couple mistakes. You guys just can't make mistakes, and then boom, you guys walk out of there with the win. That's the goal.
Well, what you do? They can't get trying to steal it at the end. This is what's so cool about it. You don't see Laker fans at this time leaving, going home. They're actually sitting in the seats watching the game. They're not looking at who's around them. They're looking at the game. And that, to me, was when the Laker fans turned into basketball fans during the 80s, during that time.
Right. And, I think all the credit goes – the credit should go to both – the Lakers and the Celtics in that regard. And you alluded to this earlier, that this really jump-started the NBA and made it to what it was. Because I think for the Laker fans, at least, they were going to the Forum for a show. But then they realized a beautiful game was being played. And what they appreciated, even though they say they hated the Celtics, without that villain, without your guys' hard work, competitiveness. From this point of view, you're right. You guys made Laker fans love basketball, not just going to the Forum. So, you can't have one without the other. So this really is like the greatest rivalry in sports. I don't know, as basketball fans, it's easy for us to say that. But, right here, you're seeing it right here, and you lived it.
Yeah. Did knowing they were there make you guys all better, because you knew that, these were the guys that you were going to have to match up against, Magic Johnson and Kareem, the end,
We knew that in order to cross that line, that's what we were going to have to do. But we know we need a stop here. Let's see who's going to make this stop. I love this. All these guys are afraid to shoot now. They want to go to Kareem. We're trying to make sure we come down. Here I am with a little bit of double. Michael Cooper, you going to shoot it? Kareem, no. We want you to shoot that one. Damn, they got the rebound there?
Oh.
Now they're running down, running the clock down. So you think right now that, they have a shot at this thing.
Right, they're good. Like, look at this. They're just going punch five. Oh, wow. Magic. Oof.
Yeah, and so Magic's going to get fouled and go to the line here. Man. I think we might push. It's the notes we have, I will say, are you were down 5 under 1 minute left. So it's looking like, you're really about to. Definitely looks like the Lakers.
They definitely have the advantage. And, Magic knocks down the first free throw. Where do we go at? I'm trying to figure out, right now you're looking going, I know we won this game. How did we tie this thing up? Look at that stat line, man. That's crazy.
Did you feel like Magic could have scored more? I know he was a passer. He's got 20 in this game right now. But did you feel like he could have asserted himself just a little bit more and put pressure on you guys instead of just feeding it to Kareem? Oh, he's...
Wow. Wow.
Look at Chief.
Beast. Man.
And one.
Battle.
Big fella. Big fella doesn't get rattled, and one.
Can't give him 3.
That was incredible.
That was incredible. Who wants some more?
No box out.
And remember, he's playing with five fouls right now. And I think this is always a sign of a great player. I know I can only speak for so much, but Kobe played great with five fouls too. And Chief, he got five fouls a while ago. We were talking about that. And for him to guard Kareem with five fouls and stay in this game, imagine if he fouled out. You guys couldn't get that rebound there. It would be a lot harder. And the game might have been different. But, man, Chief is just an incredible player.
It's nut-cutting time now. I can tell you that.
All right, you're on Coop. Really, they're trying to get it to Kareem. Oh, on the other side of the floor. Well, he liked great that side, team. Though.
Uh-oh. I
mean, ooh, someone fouled?
Holding it down Kareem on the boards.
Look at the acrobatics by the ref there. Really going with the call. Wow.
Just cursing.
Who fouled who?
It was his moment. Oh, it was
Kareem
his moment.
Kareem fouled out. You were right. Kareem fouls out. Oh, man. But there you go. That's the IQ of the game, right? Kareem fouls out, but Parrish, he's had five fouls and he stays in. I mean, it just shows you that. That's why, like, I think the foul game, you know, is so important, because basketball is the only sport where you could foul out, you know, six fouls and you're done. All these other sports, you know, you can foul as many times as you want. So fouling is important. I don't know.
How is Larry?
I think off the rebound. I think off the rebound is over the back.
Got pushed by Kareem. In the back. Yeah.
Oh, it was Parrish.
These are clutch free throws right here.
Is there anyone else you would rather be taking these?
Not in this world. Not in this world. It must be from Mars or something. Not in this world.
It was so good. Parrish didn't even go to box in. He was on the other side of the floor. He already knew Larry was gonna make those. He's like, "You guys don't need my rebound, and it's fine."
Now we got our big defenders out here playing, and it was a high level. The game is tied. They got it with 16 seconds. It's still on their fingertips. Who are they gonna go to? That's what you're looking at. Who the heck are they gonna go to?
And then they're up 3-1. No, that's tough. They just,
I mean,
you think about guys, okay, we're gonna go to this guy or this guy. Who's gonna be that guy that they're gonna go to?
So I don't remember exactly. I think they're gonna drop for Worthy. Personally, would have gone with Magic, but we already know who's, I think Worthy, they might go for him.
Magic does not want that ball right now.
Okay, so they gotta go to Worthy.
The guy that you probably want to go to is Worthy for a jump shot. If I was Pat Riley, I think I'd have brought maybe Bob McAdoo back in this game. McAdoo put a little bit more in my heart as a shooter. So now we got 16 seconds with our basketball lives in hand. Now what do you do? Kareem can no longer play. Sit on the sideline, big fella. You're my fave, but we're done with you. We don't have to see you no more this game.
And to be fair with Magic, right? Magic had his most signature moment with Kareem not playing, you know, jumping the. So you don't want him to touch the ball, but he had a chance right here to you know, have another signature moment. I'm just saying. I mean, I guess it's not going to work out.
Yeah, you did. How'd that work out?
Not well. It did not.
All right, let's see what happens.
We got our best defensive team out there. You got two guys who block shots. You got myself, you got Larry, and you got Dennis Johnson. What? How are you getting into the paint? All right, James Worthy right now.
The telecast is on it. Yeah, they're like, James Worthy, he's 10 for 14. They should go to him. And I believe you're matched up.
This was the play. I think this is where Robert Parrish. No, I thought that was it. He didn't, though. Riding Magic pretty good. All right, you got your shot right there, big fella.
He was hoping now.
Wow, look at this.
This is a steal by Robert Parrish.
Oh, no. Oh, yeah. Okay, yes. I thought so. So this is Tragic Johnson.
Don't feel so bad with your Laker hat on. It's not going to go your way, okay? This is good steal. Robert Parrish just steps over, grabs a basketball.
And, you know, that wasn't a switch there. You guys lined up with Parrish on Worthy with Kareem out. This was something that you know, Casey Jones told probably Parrish, you know, you got Worthy because they're probably going to go to him, you know? And that was just, and the length of Parrish there, you know, obviously
that got is
the steal. That wasn't a switch. That was a matchup. If you look at the inbounds, Parrish is guarding Worthy, which, you know, Worthy's a forward and Parrish is a center. That was an incredible call.
Robert has this length about him, and he was long enough to grab that basketball before Worthy was able to touch it. Look at the stat line on Robert, 11 for 22 steals. This was that kind of game. All right, Laker fans, move back a little bit here. Let's see if Celtics can get a shot. Now, what I was fearful—
can we get the Larry shot here?
I don't know if Larry got it. All I was fearful for was them making a steal and James Worthy flying up the floor with a couple of seconds trying to dunk it. The back pick, got the ball to Larry for the shot, one leg.
And it's
to win it.
Mikhail with an incredible look, couldn't get it to go. And Bird, even though that was a tough shot over two guys, one-footed going to his left, it hit front rim. I bet he thought it was good.
Gentlemen, didn't that just look like the shot that was taken against the Miami Heat this year?
It did.
Celtics take a shot. Marcus takes it. Ball almost goes in, look like it's going down. What happens? Kevin McHale on the other side. Ball bounces in. He has a chance to tap it in to win it and just misses it at the buzzer.
Those long arms of Kevin McHale. Because Kurt's
just like, wow.
Kurt Rambis was right there, but Kevin McHale just had the edge.
Celtics got a better shot. Kevin was too big for him. He tried to box him out. There was no push off here. Good shot. And doesn't push off, but all he does
is go
straight up. Rambis couldn't get there, and Kevin just
used the bank.
The little bunny there.
Oh, man, he used the bank. He got this, all rim.
This is what it boils down to, gentlemen. This is good stuff. Now this
we got bonus basketball.
Now, KC, why you got me on the bench? I have no idea. I don't know.
You did.
Well, how's the confidence with Kareem on the bench? You know, does that are you worried? Does that matter at all? Is that helping? Trying not to worry about
this because
of course, because they're guys.
Kareem was the ultimate weapon. When they essentially land Celtics, if you can beat us right now by taking the jump shot, you can go ahead and do it. Dennis Johnson, yes.
DJ's, if he had a weakness in his game, it was that outside shot. Tommy Heinsohn talked about it pregame. You know, he basically called DJ out and he was calling for Wedman to play more a little bit because he was an outside shooter. Gerald Henderson was in the game. Obviously, he could hit that outside shot, but DJ stepping up big time. Remember, he was a finals MVP in 78, so he's no stranger to big moments. So for him to step up outside of his comfort zone there is just absolutely awesome.
Well, just keeping them right now at bay. Robert Parrish, somebody has to take this shot. Dennis Johnson again misses this one. But Kevin McHale on that offside, killing that glass, man.
I think his size, like you said, and his length, it snuck up on guys, man, because he wasn't as athletic, right? He couldn't jump as much, but he was just so big, and his arms are so long that he was just able to, you know, bring in those rebounds.
A lot of people like to talk about.
Man, you think of it again, very much like Jokic with those long arms.
Yeah.
Not big, not strong.
Oh, does he foul out there? Oh, man.
I was going to say, a lot of people like to talk about the lack of court spacing, which it is, I would say, kind of even
Robert Parrish just fouled out, Jim.
Some of these spot-up jump shots being 2 feet away. But, people are not talking about these offensive rebounds. You know, I feel like, you know, back – the offensive rebounding, the level that we're watching at, like, compared to today, it's just at a much higher level.
Man, this is
here this comes Max. Got to be Max, right? You got to be coming in, right, for Parrish?
Oh, of course. I should have been in already, but okay.
Oh, man. I love it.
I tell you what, pressure will bust a pipe, though. Swin Nader Russ.
Yes.
Swin Nader, really good player. One time he led the league in rebounding a couple of years when he played with the Clippers. And remember, he played with, I want to say he played with Walton when he was at UCLA as a backup center.
Oh, did he? And he would have played with Jamal Wilkes as well if he was on that squad, because they were playing together.
I think he was it during that time. But boy, your arm gets a little tight right now when it's time to shoot free throws now in this kind of game.
All right, you guys are up one. 3 minutes, okay.
Clock ticking, baby. Tick, 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 tick.
Does overtime feel faster or longer than the 5 minutes when you're in the moment there, especially in this setting, NBA Finals, bonus time?
It really doesn't. It seems like it seems like you're both of you young men, so. But there was a game called Miss Pac-Man at one time, and used to be going good stuff. And then all of a sudden, they got this little red button that you could mash, and man, that game picked up the super speed. That's what happens especially when you're playing in this kind of environment. The game just picks up speed tremendously. Damn, Gerald, you missed two free throws. Everybody got a little choke in them.
For sure, for sure. Was there someone that you guys were all looking for to go to, though, in these closing moments? Like, would it be more?
Well, you definitely wanted to say Larry. Me against my guy, Bob McAdoo. No, Bob, that ain't going, brother.
Whoa.
Oh, let's great go. Steal. Mm-hmm. Look at that fast break. He gets fouled. When no one's running with you, you just got to take it to the basket because, you know.
Gerald Henderson, so athletic this time, able to get here, steal this ball from McAdoo and run down the floor. And now looking, Gerald's just able to jump by, go into Cooper as Cooper bangs him with the body. Now, Gerald, can you make a couple free throws, buddy? Or you can't.
There you go.
How often were you at the free throw line during the stretch of these big games? How were you feeling?
I was a lot early. I don't think in later I was, but down the line, I think that, you know, I was early in my career. But we got so many players that I became like a third or fourth option.
Oh,
wow.
Man. He reminds me so much of like an Eastern Conference rival that you guys had some classic battles with, Dominique Wilkins, where Worthy and Wilkins could shoot the mid-range, but they really wanted to suck you in, drive, and go up with their athleticism and their explosiveness. Two of my favorite
forget
players.
Forget about him. Let's talk about Bernard King. Bernard King was the daddy. You know, you can talk about, you know, Dominique and all that. Bernard King put them guys to shame, and he was the one guy that, you know, it was tough guarding him. Damn. Where did King miss?
Oh, good. Pulling up the pressure. You guys are playing a lot faster than I had expected. But like you said, maybe the game is just picking up speed and you guys are getting caught up in it. There's another fifth foul. A lot of fouling. It's the physicality we were talking about.
Fifth foul. Our guys have to get up, and it becomes a little chess match. Like, who's going to blink? Obviously, look at James Worthy. He is scoring on everybody. I don't think I guarded him in this particular juncture. Dennis Johnson nails one down. That's all you want to do. Just keep it close. You keep it close, man. This is
clutch.
Whew. I can feel my heart's beating right now pretty good. Man. God bless his soul, man. Passed away probably about 10, 12 years ago, man. One of my best friends, but one of the all-time greats, man. Just one of the all-time greats.
Absolutely. I believe he was multiple-time all-defensive team, too. And that's when we talked about earlier, he's guarding Magic right now. You guys had 100% trust in him because he was just so underrated in history. That's Worthy again, and he gets the foul. Man,
TJ's ready for the moment. Worthy, wow, just on the other end. Because, you know, without Kareem and with Magic being pass first at times, you know, the baby skyhook happened in, later down the line. You know, I was wondering who are they going to go to. And James Worthy. Thought we were calling him Small Game James.
Don't worry. It happened in a minute. It's coming.
Yeah.
It is. Up till now, though, it was looking good.
You guys are looking for Bird. It's just not there. The intensity is so high.
Here we go. There you go. Found him. Great patience.
He knew what he wanted to do before he even caught the ball. You know, he catches Michael the ball Cooper. And just executes.
They got him one-on-one quick, too. Down low deep.
They're going to McAdoo.
Wow.
Big board by Mikhail. And you guys are running. Wow.
Yeah, they keep looking to push. This is interesting.
What are we looking for? I think we're looking for Bird coming off. Gerald Henderson, little jump shot. Dennis Johnson gets fouled, steps through, gets no foul.
Oh, late whistle. Wow.
Load the breath.
How loud was it? Was it you can't hear each other talk?
The noise level was incredible. But I thought Dennis Johnson, are they calling a foul here with Dennis Johnson? Yeah,
looks like he does get fouled. And it was a late whistle, I think. Or maybe
it was. Whoa.
Technical. No.
Whoa.
Okay.
You got hit on the arm.
What are they call? What are they discussing here? Because
this delay that they say or intentional foul. There's none of that. So.
Right.
Or replays or anything. Like, there's no overturning. Now,
here's the thing that would happen differently. Dennis Johnson is hovering over the referees. You think of what happened. The security now comes and pushes you away from any time the officials are going to the scorer's table.
I think he just ordered some takeout right there. I'm not buying it. I mean, the call was pretty clear. He was just on the telephone. What is the call here?
I don't know what the call is. What is the call? Well, Magic is at the free throw line, obviously.
Yeah.
And they're down by. I know this game don't go to no double overtime, John. I think this game
it does not.
All right, Tragic. Come on, give me something.
This is what happens. That's why we're saying tragic.
There you go, Tragic.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. Look at that stat line.
Jared, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Tragic Johnson was born here.
Uh-oh.
Not a shooter. Well,
so compounded with the pass.
Magic is on the line and missed two clutch free throws? And they got a statue of him outside the building? Is it where we're going?
To be fair, they have a lot of stuff.
Look at this shot. Look at this
Don't
shot.
Don't cry nothing to hear though.
They can't watch.
Get your head
Byron
up,
Scott
man.
Can't watch. Oof. Oh, my gosh. Oof.
Well, yeah. So after this, Magic was known as Tragic Johnson. It became a whole storyline.
Yeah, Magic had his moment then. He had a chance to shoot two free throws and take the lead. With 34
Did anyone
seconds
call him back. Tragic to his face on the court?
Yeah, we would. Yeah, I would.
At that time. Yes.
At that time,
That's
I would.
That's all I needed to know.
If you're afraid, get a dog, man. If you're afraid, get a dog.
I love that.
That is
all right, so I think the game's it's tied up, right? So you guys
tied
need
up,
a
buddy.
Bucket. Let's see what we get here. Cooper has fallen on the ground three times.
Ooh.
Oh, no.
Wow.
Now we're scrambling.
He's
We've recovered.
Larry. Ooh. All-time shot.
You see the quickness?
He worked so hard to even get that. He worked so hard to get that ball.
Right when he's getting the pass, when he's receiving it, he knows what he wants to do. The play before that when he got that bucket.
He's already hit that guy in the back. He already bounced Magic off. So he knew he was going to get some separation with the jump shot then. And this is where, you know, you give him the basketball. He knows Magic is fronting him. But look at the bump. Bump there, and that gave him the separation. Knocked down the shot.
That's what Hakeem did so good. As soon as he caught the ball, he was already doing, you know, his dream shake. Yes. He was already doing his array post moves. Even Mikhail was good at that too. Mikhail's up and under was just deadly. But that's what great post players do. That's why sometimes I get frustrated watching now. Guys don't really know how to play in the post. They just dribble back down. It's just not how it works like that.
No. It's just changed now.
Right. All right. Let's see how we choke on this one.
How you adjudicate this?
Oh, we're having a hard time even getting the ball in. James. To Worthy. Air ball.
They called the foul. They called it, yeah.
They called the foul. It's all right.
ML Carr's in for defense?
Defense. Uh-oh. My guy James, get your head up, Kareem.
Not a good sign.
Kareem.
Not a good sign.
Why was James Worthy on the looking at Kareem?
Uh-oh. Watch this. Poor James. Oh. Choked.
Man.
Choked. Tell.
Oh, my. Front rim, too.
Yeah.
And it sounded so brutal, the rim just rattling. You could just hear it. And you were talking about the noise earlier. The crowd silent. Kareem's got his head in his arms. Dude. It's just bad body language. It's all dude, around you just tragic.
At this point, you could hear a small mouse pee on cotton. That's how quiet it was in that building.
Ooh. Oh, man.
This is over. And Dennis Johnson gets up. My man Bones, he's automatic. He has no fear. He's already winking his eye.
He doesn't look scared at all.
Think about it. He was from Dennis Johnson played at Pepperdine, which was right outside of LA.
I didn't know that. Oh, nothing but net. Nothing but net.
There we go.
Swish.
No tragic there.
DJ.
Yeah. His nickname stayed intact. Just DJ.
21 points
tonight.
Almost double what he's been averaging. That's the value of having, you know, guys that have been there before. You know, like we said, he won the finals MVP in 78. You won the finals MVP in 81. You know, Larry Bird would go on to win finals MVP. You guys are just so savvy. You guys were mentally strong. Like I said, it looked like you guys were the team that were up 2-1 in this. And man, it's just, this is just one of the best finals games ever.
All you know now is the places got quiet and all those people were jumping up. All them Laker fans who were cheering and just throwing their popcorn and just being so happy. And all of a sudden, wait a minute, we're down right now by 3. We need, and here's the thing about 3-point shots at that time were so rare. You didn't even think about, you know, getting beat that way because the 3-point shot wasn't the threat it is now. Like if you had this ball now and you had Steph Curry out there, you're going, uh-oh, we got some problems. Mm-hmm. Or Klay Thompson or, you know, the great 3-point shooters in the NBA. But then that wasn't the shot. That was the shot that people were taking, knocking down.
Right. Being up 3 in 84 is.
You immediately went to the basket.
There's red.
You know, you guys weren't looking like when you were down 5 with a minute left. You know, it wasn't like, let's get a 3 really quickly. You immediately went to the basket and got the N1.
That was the one. Robert Parrish gets the N1. That was big. And Robert Parrish makes the 2 free throws to tie it up. Big. And now you are. A point you are 10 seconds away from tying it up, being up, tying it up 2-2 instead of being down 3-1 and going back to Boston. Now you've taken home court advantage back, and now you have the critical game 5 in Boston, where we made sure that my guy Jim Cantore with the Weather Channel turned the temperature up to about 100 degrees in the building and 115 actually on the floor. So now where do you go at, Magic? You're so happy.
Yeah. So the telecast is showing Michael Cooper because he was technically their best three-point shooter. But again, none of these guys were really known for their range. So being up 3 and 84 was a lot different than now.
ML
Here's a steal.
Carr makes the steal.
And he dunked on it.
That is a tough way to tie it.
Oops.
Can't say the Lakers didn't have their chances in this one. Plenty of them.
So while
we have you though, because we're not going to be able to unfortunately watch the rest of the series with you, at least here, maybe one.
You
game.
Should,
but you know what? I'm open whenever. But while we have you, any memories stick out for game 5, 6, and 7 here? You know, you were talking about the sweating, but the game 7 here, you know, to close it out.
Game 7 was just, it was a 9 o'clock game at night. That's what made it crazy. It was 9 o'clock at night. And
oh my goodness.
I think just, you know, the way they felt, 9 o'clock game, East Coast time, so everybody could see it. That's when the game started. And yeah, here we are. It is now 2-2. And we have done what we needed to do to tie this series up. And that ML Carr talking a lot of noise. We got to go back to Boston. And here come the Lakers. And here we are. It is 2-2, overtime game. And the good guys have tied it up. The dark side now is crying.
That's right. And it should be noted, Max, you were the leading scorer for your squad in game 7. So to win the championship, to win it all. So
duly noted, yeah. Man. Don't even say that. You know, let me give
duly
you my
noted.
Stat line in that game. 24-8-8 in that game with not
yes,
a three-pointer.
Sir.
So let me give you my stat line early in that game. All right. That's what happened. And I was being guarded by James Worthy at the time. And I made sure I gave him some choice words that I cannot use right now anymore without saying about him and his family and his whoever else wanted to hear it.
Always stepping up, NBA Finals MVP, big time performances in Game 7s, of course. Everyone who has watched, thank you so much for watching. Please make sure to download the NBA app. Make sure to download to follow the NBA on all of their socials. Mr. Cedric Maxwell, again, it has been an absolute honor to watch this game with you. You know, I think Jaron will say the exact same. This has been incredible.
I don't think he would say that.
I think
you're teasing.
So again, I think this huge bold move by him. How do we feel now that we're at the end of the stream? He never took the hat off, to be fair.
That's right. Stay true. Like
now
I said,
you can take that hat and shove it where you need. No, you're my guy now. I will always be a fan of your show. Guys, I totally enjoyed this. It was wonderful. Can't wait for us to do it again on NBA TV. This was really a treat for me, talking about the Celtics being able to beat the bad guys in LA, sending the people home and sending the kids home crying. I absolutely loved it. God bless America.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. And everyone, we can watch, of course, the NBA Finals are resuming tomorrow. Game 3, we are going to see who's really about it. Jokic, Jimmy Butler. I'm excited. Cannot wait to see what happens. And again, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, guys.